Hi everyone, this is the preview lecture for lecture 3. In the previous lecture, lecture 2, we have discussed about how can we solve an eigenvalue equation. So if you remember, then the equation we have solved was something like this. This is the operator of our interest, and minus k square can be regarded as eigenvalue of this eigenproblem. So this is one category of problems of our interest during in this course. Today we'll introduce a different type of problem of our interest. This is differential equation. Especially, we are interested with differential equation with boundary conditions as a typical example and most relevant example. I wanted to start from Laplace equation today. Laplace equation simply means that we have Laplacian operator exerted on our scalar function. Then it generates zero at any position inside our domain. So simply, this is the Laplace equation. And as you can see, the operator related with this Laplace equation is Laplacian. We can find that for both cases, there we have a common operator, Laplacian operator. Since we have discussed about Laplacian operator in 3D and 1D, we don't have to repeat it again. So let's quickly discuss about it. Laplace equation is a second order differentiation. However, in 1D case, we can neglect this y-directional and z-directional dependencies under the assumption of homogeneity along y-direction and z-direction. So Laplace equation, therefore, in 1D becomes just second order derivative of our scalar function becomes zero. Of course, it should be accompanied with boundary conditions. Where can you find it? What is its application? In this course, it is closely related to the Poisson equation. So the Poisson equation the term of the Poisson equation appears frequently in this course. At the end of this preview lecture, I will show you the exact meaning of Poisson equation. Before starting our numerical solution procedure, first, consider analytic solution. Yes, our domain is once again between 0 to A. And we have to specify the values of our solution function phi at two boundary points. For example, phi at x equal 0 and phi at x equal a should be specified. In this case, in this slide, we have specified 0 and 1 for these two points. So graphically, if we draw it, then this is the x-axis, real space position, and this is our solution. And let's say that this is x equal to 0, and this is x equal to a. Then, with this boundary condition, we can certainly say that at x equal 0, we have phi equal to 0. And how about x equal to a? In this case, solution value should be 1. Therefore, we have a point like this. Yes, these two points are already given, and the remaining task is, of course, what happens in between. What is the expected shape of our solution phi? So this is the goal. Anyway, it is easy to solve by analytic means. This is 1D Laplace equation, and second derivative of our phi function vanishes, we can expect the solution function phi over x becomes at most a linear function, the first order function for independent variable x. So let's assume that there occurs x dependent term and constant term, and we have undefined coefficient like c1 and c0. Up to now, we have no idea about what is the exact value of phi. So please remember that here, up to this position, we have not used the boundary condition. This is just obtained from the property of equation itself, Laplacian equation itself. And now we want to introduce boundary condition to specify the value of undefined coefficients like C1 and C0. When we apply phi at 0, then it becomes simply C0, and that should be 0 by our predefined boundary condition. Oh, therefore C0 vanishes. And how about phi at a? In this case, we have C1a, and according to our boundary condition, it should be 1. Therefore, we find that C1 is just 1 over A. So phi over x is just x over A. Then why don't you just draw it in this figure? When we insert x equal to 0, then phi becomes 0, of course. And when we insert x equal to A, then it becomes 1 as expected, and in between we have just a linear function. Yes, so we have a linear function. This looks like a trivial problem. However, don't be too much disappointed. Later we can easily introduce more difficult problems. Then our goal is now to solve the Laplace equation with the help of a computer program. So we have to first, what is the solution vector? But you know that we have discussed this concept already in the previous lecture, lecture 2. So we can just repeat it. Once we introduce uniformly distributed grid points starting from x1, which is corresponding to 0, and xn, which is corresponding to a, then it is sufficient to have phi 1, phi 2, up to phi n minus 1, and finally phi n. Previously, in the case of our infinite potential wave problem, we assume that this becomes 0 and this becomes 0 automatically by our boundary condition. Then we took only these net component starting from phi 2 up to phi n minus 1. But in this time, we will just leave it. So we will keep both of phi 1 and phi n in the solution vector. Okay, then now our goal becomes calculate all n double numbers defined at those x points. So although that gives us just a finite number of unknown variables, but we believe that, or we are satisfied with that finite information. Then the next question is, how can we discretize the Laplacian operator? Oh, however, we have done it before. In lecture 2, we have discussed how can we discretize our Laplacian operator at position x equal to xi. Please remember that it is the expression for second order derivative of our function f around x equal to xi. So when we just switch from x equal to xi, x equal to xi plus 1, or x equal to xi minus 1, we can generate many different realization of this second order derivative. So if we consider only one specific example, why don't you just look at the second order derivative at x equal to xi. Then this line can be expressed by this matrix and vector multiplication. Of course, this matrix is just a row matrix, not a square matrix, but later we can easily make it as a square matrix. So please check that this one is really corresponding to the above expression. So let's do it. Starting from this first entry, we have to make a product between 0 and phi 1. That gives just 0. And the next one, also since that is 0, it gives 0. Until we find this non-zero element 1. This is corresponding to I minus 1's entry, then we will have 1 times phi I minus 1, and the next one becomes minus 2 times now phi I, and finally this one gives 1 multiplied by phi I plus 1. The other components like this one also gives just 0 because the coefficient itself 0. So whatever value you have, this one gives you just 0. up to the last component, 0. So when we just collect non-zero component from this long line, then we will find just phi I plus 1 minus 2 times phi I plus phi I minus 1. So from this simple manipulation, you can find the equivalent relation between the above expression and this below matrix vector multiplication. Okay, so this is just for a certain position happen to be x equal to xi. My question is, what happens if we consider different index for I instead of x equal to xi? If we are considering x equal to xi plus 1, then what will happen? Can you write down the expected equation? Yes, you can. So if we write down, then we will find that this is 1 over delta x squared, and we will have a row vector n. It has, in most cases, it has all zero component and only 3 entries are not zero. Where can you find the non-zero entries? We can find at I plus 1th entry and also I plus 2th entry and ith entry. It will be, once again, 1 minus 2, 1. It looks quite similar with the previous one. However, although the sequence 1 minus 2, 1, 1 minus 2, 1 is found in common, however, their location is shifted by amount of 1. The starting point of this sequence is I minus 1. However, the starting point of this sequence is I's position. So we have a different starting position, and here we have the same vector phi 1, phi 2, up to phi n. It becomes once again 0. So you can generate many different versions with xi plus 2 or xi minus 1, xi minus 2. Any index can be inserted into this position, that position, another position, that will generate many different matrix vector multiplication. In this case, let me compare these two representative cases. For example, here, you know, in this case we have a solution vector and also we have solution vector. We can easily recognize that they are the same matrix. So we can just merge it like phi 1 up to phi n and generate this 2 by 1 vector by just stacking these two row vectors. So I want to say here we have a matrix whose size is 2 by n, and in most cases it has 0, 0, 0, 0 at most cases. But it No. It's I's position and I minus 1, I plus 1, I plus 2 is given by 1 minus 2, 1, 0, also 0, 1 minus 2, 1. Uh-huh. So by just stacking these two row vectors, then we can find all matrix. Then if we repeat this procedure again and again and again, what will happen? If we just stack this procedure again and again, then what will happen? If we consider n equal to 5 example, then we can consider the positions like x2, x3, and x4. For these three points, we can build a matrix vector multiplication, and after that, we can stack them. If we stack them all, then eventually we will have something like this. 1 over delta x square and 1 minus 2, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1 minus 2, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1 minus 2, 1 times. Here we have phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, up to phi 5 equal to 0, 0, 0. You know that this is the result of stacking the Laplacian equation evaluated at three different positions. Now the matrix becomes 3 by 5. And unknown vector or solution vector is just 5 by 1 vector. You know, in this case, it is difficult to uniquely define the solution vector because since we have 5 unknown variables, we have to have 5 equations. But from the Laplacian equations, the number of available equations is just 3, not 5. Unfortunately, we need 2 more conditions to augment this Laplacian equation. How can you find these 2 missing conditions? That is provided from the boundary condition. Please remember the boundary condition once again. It was phi 1 equal to 0 and phi n equal to 1. Then how can we express this phi 1 equal to 1 in terms of a matrix vector multiplication, a row vector multiplied by a column vector? In this case, if we wanted to select only phi 1, the simple way is just to keep here 1 and all other components are set to be 0. Then here we have phi 1 up to phi n. Now it simply gives you just phi 1 because 1 multiplied by phi 1 gives phi 1 and all other components gives you just identically 0, and this one equal to number 0. Let me repeat this second boundary condition once again. How can you select phi n instead of phi 1? In this case, we set all other components up to n minus 1's entry to 0, and finally set only the nth entry to 1. And here we have a phi 1 and phi n. Then we can select phi n. And according to our boundary condition, we have non-zero values. Here happen to be 1, so we can have number 1. Therefore, we have provide 2 additional equations for our Laplace equation. Then, 2 additional equations should be incorporated into our Laplacian equation. So, how can you do that? Here we have 3 by 5 matrix, and if we add 2 more equations, then we can make it as 5 by 5. Then how can you do that? It is easy to just eliminate this 1 over delta x squared. If we multiply delta x squared in the left hand side and right hand side, then what will happen? This one just goes away by becoming unity, and this multiplication does nothing. Now we have this scaled form for our Laplace equation. Then we can add 2 additional equations like 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, corresponding to the boundary condition at x equal to 0. In this case, its value was just 0. And do you remember the boundary condition for xn? In that case, it was 0, 0, 0, 0. Only the final nth one should be 1. And the right-hand side was not 0, but 1. This one. So, finally, we have a form of a square matrix and a column vector and another column vector. So the product between a square matrix and a vector is a vector. Let's write down in this way. A matrix times x vector becomes a b vector. So A, x becomes b. This is the Laplace equation for n equal to 5 example. If we wanted to extend it to, for example, n equal to 7 case, then how can you make it? Do you have any idea about the form of A matrix and X vector and B vector? So I can say easily, and you can too. So if we have n equals 7 example, then our solution vector would be just 7 by 1 column vector. It contains phi 1, phi 2, up to phi 7. And here we have also 7 by 7 matrix, and its 1,1 component becomes 1 by the boundary condition, and its 7 by 7 component 1 by another boundary condition. And starting from this second row, third row, fourth, fifth, sixth, we have to introduce Laplace equation itself, and it just have a stamp like this, 1, minus 2, 1, and just to move it one step down and one step right, 1, minus 2, 1, 1, minus 2, 1, 1, minus 2, 1, 1, minus 2, 1. That will completely describe our A matrix for n equal to 7 example. How about this component? If not specified as a non-zero value, we assume that all other entries have a value of 0. And now consider, finally consider the B vector. It should be also 7 by 1 column vector, and here we have 0. Why do we have 0? This is due to boundary condition. And from second component to sixth component, we have once again 0. However, this is nothing related with boundary condition, but they are 0 only because we are working with Laplace equation. And finally, we have number 1 corresponding to our boundary condition. We can make a computer program for arbitrary n values. If we have, for example, 100, then you can just consider a 100 by 100 matrix and 100 by 1 column vectors to fill this system. Let's just solve it. So here I prepared already the MATLAB examples, but instead of just looking them, why don't you just type it now? Here, who's? Oh, there is nothing. Then let me make a matrix, A matrix. It is assumed to be 5, 5 matrix. Here, yes. So we have prepared just a null matrix whose size is 5 by 5. And now I wanted to fill certain components corresponding to our Laplace equation. For example, A, 1, 1 component is 1. And 5, 5 component, that is 1. They are describing the boundary condition. And how about this? A, our second row, starting from 2, 1, 2, 3, now become just 2, 1, minus 2, 1. Then, we have specified the second row, and this sequence can be inserted to third row, but with shifted index. Okay, and the fourth one. Now it becomes from 3 to 5. Okay, I have constructed the A matrix correctly. And how about B matrix? You know, we have A matrix and X column vector and B column vector. The goal is to calculate X matrix. So we will not specify X. Instead, we will specify A and B, and from them, we wanted to find out a column vector x satisfy ax equal to b. Then let me just specify also null vector whose size is 5 times 1, and in this case only non-zero component is its fifth one, its value was 1. Okay, then let me just type that a correctly inserted, and b, and let's try to find out the solution of ax equal to b. Of course, that does not work in MATLAB. How can you find such a x value? In order to find it, then we have to introduce our backslash notation in MATLAB. You know that this is really specific for MATLAB. If you are working in Python, then you have a different grammar. But in the case of MATLAB, this is the way to find out the solution of ax equal to b. Then let me just type. Oh, now we have x starting from 0 and ends up 1. And here in between, we have linearly varying values for x. We have solved the Laplace equation with help of computer programs. Up to now, we have solved a simple equation like second derivative of phi becomes 0 and phi at 0 becomes 1 and phi at a becomes 1. We have solved a simple problem. So your question would be, why do we care about this simple, seemingly just mathematical equation? What is physical law related with this Laplace equation? I will try to explain it from now on. So, in a mathematical sense, Laplacian equation means that a Laplacian operator exerted on our function gives just 0. This is a Laplacian equation. Okay, this is good example in the one-dimensional problem. Also, we have the Poisson equation. In the case of a Poisson equation, the operation, the Laplace operator exerted on the solution function does not change. The difference occurs in this right-hand side. In the case of a Laplace equation, it was the right-hand side was always 0 by definition of Laplace equation. In the case of a Poisson equation, we have general non-zero function. If we say a Poisson equation has zero source everywhere, then it just reduced to Laplace equation. So we will talk about Poisson equation. However, in computational electronics, even the generalized Poisson equation is called simply the Poisson equation. Then question is, what is the exact meaning of the generalization? That is related with our material system. So consider this equation. This is nothing but Gauss law. The net charge density is a source of electric field. However, we can easily consider different form, slightly different form. For example, since you are coming from some related background, then you can easily understand, yes, of the form of Gauss law. Then, what is the difference between this Gauss law in its original form and the form written with displacement vector? And when we consider certain dielectric material, then the material itself responds to the external electric field. So it generates polarization. Instead of the electric field, it is more frequently written with the displacement vector. And we have an assumption that between displacement vector and electric field vector, there exists a proportionality. So there is a certain proportional coefficient epsilon, and that is called permittivity. So for vacuum, then this permittivity happened to be just permittivity of vacuum. However, if we have dielectric material like silicon dioxide or silicon, then we have certain deviation from epsilon naught. For example, in the case of a silicon, the typical value we will use is 11.7. So silicon's permittivity is 11.7 times larger than vacuum permittivity. And in the case of a silicon dioxide, it is about 3.9 times larger than vacuum permittivity. So, point is, our system sometimes can have different materials, like this is silicon and this is silicon dioxide. Therefore, epsilon is not a constant in this case. We can have a position-dependent permittivity. Now, let me just write down this equation in terms of permittivity and electric field. Permittivity, which can depend on position, and electric field, of course, it can depend on position, and it becomes just net charge density law. And when we introduce the electrostatic approximation, then we can express our electric field by gradient of electrostatic potential. So the final form just reads like this. Differential operator, and here we have epsilon and gradient of phi now becomes minus. Here minus comes from this minus, and rho, net charge density, which can be a function of position. When we have a look at this Gauss law in terms of electrostatic potential, how does it look like? Can you identify it as a Poisson equation? It can be identified as Poisson equation only when epsilon is a constant. When epsilon is a constant over the position, then we can just pull this epsilon out of a differential equation. Then yes, we can write down in this way. Also, we understand this gradient first taking gradient and taking divergence later, that is actually corresponding to Laplacian operator. And this epsilon can be shifted to the right hand side, then we can have this final form. Okay, this form is really Poisson equation. So this equation can be called as the Poisson equation. This is a solution vector, and this is a Laplacian operator, and this is a source function. So at the beginning of computational microelectronics, they called it as a Poisson equation. There is no problem. However, when we have different materials, we cannot solve this equation. This is not valid for position-dependent permittivity. We have to generalize it to this form. Unfortunately, this one, in a mathematical sense, it is not a Poisson equation, because here we have position-dependent coefficient in front of this gradient operator. Although it cannot be called the Poisson equation, the similar equation has been called as Poisson equation for a long time. So the guys, the researchers in the computational microelectronics still call this generalized equation, the Gauss law itself, as Poisson equation. In a rigorous sense, this is not correct, but please take it as a habit of researchers in this field. So in the next lecture, lecture 4, we will see how can we solve this generalized Poisson equation. But for now, it is enough for today's lecture. And you have another homework, already homework number 3, and due date is next Monday, just before our lecture 4 starts. Please upload your code and report in your subfolder. We have two problems. The problem one is just to write a simple code for solving the Laplace equation. We have already done it in the lecture. However, the boundary condition was phi 0 equal to 0, phi a equal to 1. But in this case, in this problem 1, instead, please apply the boundary conditions like this. Here, now it becomes 1 and it becomes minus 1. You can easily find that the solution is still linear, but anyhow, please solve it by your computer program. And second problem is a little bit more advanced, and write a simple code for solving, not the Laplace equation. This is not Laplace equation. You know that Laplace equation itself should satisfy the second derivative of a solution vector becomes 0. But in this problem, we have non-zero source function. It is, instead of a Laplace equation, it is the Poisson equation. And this term just to represent the Dirac delta function located or centered at x equal to half a. Then maybe you are curious about how can we consider this Dirac delta function. Oh, Dirac delta function is really defined in an infinitely short range. then how can we consider such kind of short range function? Of course, we cannot find the infinite resolution for Dirac delta function. So please think that this Dirac delta function is just assigned only to a node located at half a position. Please think about how can you treat this Dirac delta function. Okay, and even in this case, we need the boundary condition, and in that case, boundary conditions are at both ends, we have just 0, and x equals 0, we have 0, and x equals a, we have a. The function values here and here, and the function value at this center point, half a, we have no idea. Actually, this is the unknown variable, and you have to solve it. That's all for lecture 3. See you tomorrow.